Welcome to our segment on science and safety, and in this segment we educate you on what it means when it comes to road safety as well as science. Many people do drive, but they are not really sure of what to do when they meet certain signs, and they cannot really interpret those signs and know what they are talking about so that they may be able to do and take appropriate action as regards to the sign. And the sign I have for today is a sign of a bridge. You know, in many roads, especially up country, and even a few roads here in Kampala, we have little bridges that do happen to be constructed in the roads, and it's very important to make the motorist aware that there is a bridge somewhere. Why? One, it could be because of the weight, because a bridge is hollow and the under section is hollow, so it's not solid. So particular type of weight may not be able to be accommodated on that bridge. Hence, it can break down the bridge. So you interpreting the bridge sign when you are away before you reach the bridge is very important. So if you are driving a vehicle or a truck which is really very heavy, and you are going to go through an area which has a bridge, then you have to think twice before you engage the bridge. Secondly, the barricades which support the bridge on the side is also very, very important. Sometimes, especially people who may not know, would want to drive on the shoulders, and they may not know that actually the shoulders are just hanging in air because there is a bridge that is passing around. So for you to have adequate warning that a bridge is in place, you have a sign that is put in place for you to be able to interpret that what is happening on that particular spot on the road is that there is a bridge. For example, the place where we are right now, there is a bridge, just a small bridge which is connecting the two, this side and the other side, because this is more of a lower altitude zone, and so water has to flow from one side to the other side, and at the same time you have the road that is passing in the same area. So to be able to incorporate both the road and also the passage of the water, the engineers had to construct a bridge. So this bridge can help you to synchronize the two, that you have the road on top and then you have a bridge under where the water can be able to pass successfully without any problem. So anytime you're driving and you come across a sign like that one, it is a sign indicating that there is a bridge, and you need to take extra caution when it comes to you driving in a particular area like that one. The chances of you damaging the road are very, very high if there was no any sign warning you of the bridge, because anyway you wouldn't know. But in this particular area, you cannot bring a 30 ton, 40 ton, 50 ton truck passing through this area. You might end up becoming an inconvenience to everybody, just because sometimes the bridge may not have the capacity to uphold that kind of weight, and so you are warned quite in advance that there is a bridge. Secondly, because it's it's sort of a valley, you also need to watch your speed. This is not a kind of bridge where you have to drive at maximum speed, so it is a warning for you, one, to take care of the weight, two, to take care even of the speed under which you drive in this particular area, and thirdly, because the road is very narrow, you have limited activity and space in that particular area, so caution must be taken when you are driving along this road or around this particular area where you have a bridge, so that you may become safe on the road, at the same time that you may make the life very conducive, especially the safety wise, to the rest of the people using this kind of road where you have a bridge that has been erected in place. So next time you're driving and you meet a sign like that, please take caution. We've seen many bridges up country that have been swept by rain, just because the ground has been made so weak due to the continuous rainfall. Secondly, we have also heard of bridges that have fallen in because of the weight that has been distributed on the bridges caused by the trucks, the heavy trucks that are using those roads. But whichever the case may be, whether there is a sign or not a sign, but once you suspect that there is a breach, sometimes it's very important to even use common sense before you actually engage that particular area. Reason being that if you don't use the common sense, you are going to become a menace, causing, you know, a hold up for everyone just because your truck broke through the bridge and then left the bridge dilapidated, that not even many people can be able to use it. So engaging the bridges with urban areas, maybe you can have road signs that warn you, but in areas which are semi-urban and also rural areas, you might not have warning signs warning you that there's a bridge in place. But whichever the case is, when you see anything that is looks like a bridge, it's important for you to stop, come out of the vehicle, inspect the bridge, and also you can even ask people around whether vehicles or trucks like your size sometimes use that particular bridge. So that at the end, when you decide to engage the bridge, then you should be able to pass that bridge without causing any problem or any damage. Otherwise, if you don't have adequate information about the strength of that bridge, then you stand a chance of damaging the road and making it impossible for anybody who will come along. The other thing is, once you have a bridge in the area and you suspect that you cannot be able to pass, it's very important to use alternative routes. Instead of you risking to cross that bridge, it's very important for you to ask the alternative route. The alternative route might be better for you, because if it has no bridge, if it is bridgeless, then your truck and your merchandise survives, and you keep the road which has a bridge functioning, that you don't become a problem for everyone else. But however, if you insist on using bridges and yet your vehicle may not be convenient in terms of weight and capacity to use that bridge, you may end up being a menace to everybody, and you may end up, you know, making life uncomfortable for the rest of the road users, just because you have not applied a bit of some wisdom in approaching the bridge. Andrew,
yes,
welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Let's talk about buses. How many buses bus companies do we have in Kampala?
Right now, the ones that are operational, if we talk about the Kampala Metropolitan and the outskirts, of course, we just have Pioneer.
Pioneer,
and okay, we can also say include Wakulenume.
Yes.
The green bus.
Yes.
But other than that, yeah, we don't have any other bus service that is firm on the ground.
Yes.
Both are struggling.
But I remember we used to have Uganda Transport Company, which was so credible.
Yes, UTC.
UTC. By the time I did my secondary school, because I joined the secondary in 1986, and I used to travel by UTC.
UTC.
So what do you think happened?
UTC just died. Like, you know how you see all the cooperative unions dying. Now the same applies to UTC. It just died, and of course, these are government ventures that, just like how you see the marketing board, even the transport sector was affected. So government thought that if privatized the transport industry and brought in other players, then it would be much better and more effective. But along the way, this is where we are now.
But I think privatization wasn't a very bad idea.
Initially,
But looking at the happening and the events of things as we speak now in the transport sector, how is it going with the Pioneer and Wakulenume in your view as a transport enthusiast?
Okay, if I take an example of Pioneer, if they had stuck to the original plan, they had a very good plan, a good work plan.
Yes.
Back in 2012, they had drivers who were experienced, had uniforms, had offices, had staff, had even a public relations person.
Yes.
But along the way, after URA came in and founded their buses over the debt, the 6 billion debt in taxes that they had in areas, then things just started going downhill.
Yeah, but did they think that they are going to operate without paying tax? Because it was not a government parastatal.
Yes.
I don't know whether they had a collabo, or it was, you know, with the government.
Government had a small stake in it, but that was supposed to help it get on its feet, and then after, become independent.
Okay, but I see a few buses on the roads.
Yeah, they are there.
you know.
They're operating at half capacity.
Yes.
Initially, they had imported 100 buses. Then after them being impounded, some broke down in the parking yard. Then the ones that you see on the road are like half of what is supposed to be, what was, because they were supposed to be 500. Now they are like, give or take, they are about 60.
Because I think there are a number of them packed in.
They have a parking area there. And that's where most of them died.
Yeah, but do you think the existing transport infrastructure can really handle buses? Do buses have a success here in Kampala?
Initially,
yes.
If like I said, if you look at the 2012 plan, the work plan for the Pioneer PEB Pioneer is bus company, when they had requested for a bus lane. They had requested for, they even put up passenger waiting areas, the stands.
Yeah.
Now when you look at what's happening today, the lanes were not provided.
The infrastructure is breaking down.
The bus stands are now no more. The employees have now left because they can't afford to pay all of them.
Yeah.
And now they're competing still with the taxis. And yet, initially, the plan was they phase out systematically the taxis from.
Talking about the plan, in your view, phasing out the taxis, I see that as a problem. However much I am not in for congestion. Because when you look at the taxi and you see the labor force that it is supporting, I mean, that wouldn't go well with the government.
It's not completely stopping the taxis from operating. It's just that the CBD is congested. CBD, in planning language, it means Central Business District.
Yes.
Okay, the metropolitan area, where the
same activity,
takes place in the city. Now, the plan was, Pioneer bus can accommodate, actually can handle, at any given time, full capacity, 60 passengers. 30 seated, 30 standing. Now a taxi can only accommodate 14.
Yes.
So
which means you need 12 taxis.
Four taxis to handle one bus.
Okay. Yeah, four taxis.
Now
into
remember,
one bus.
Now remove four taxis from the normal traffic flow. You have space.
Yes.
You understand? Yes. So imagine if you have 100 buses, that means 40 buses, I mean 40 taxis are off the road, meaning they systematically discongest the CBD.
You systematically discongest the CBD, but I'm looking at the labor force. Where do those guys go?
Where did they come from in the first place?
Yeah, because they came in to maximize business.
Yes.
Okay? Because for me, however much I'm into decongestion of the city, but I'm also thinking about the labor force and the effects of erasing the taxis out of town, and then you have the labor force, you know, trying to find a living,
to crime. Yes, but the thing was, it's not phasing them out completely.
Yes,
the buses can operate, can come to the CBD if you're bringing you. From, let's say you're coming from home, they bring you up to the city center. But a taxi is not supposed to come to the city center. It would rather stop in the outskirts. Because however much we try to fill that gap that will be left by taxis, we can't, because buses still, we are lacking. They would have to first stabilize the 500 like they had planned, first come into circulation, then after integrate completely erase the taxis. But now they can. The plan was they could first coexist. Taxis stop outside the CBD, then it's only Pioneer buses that can access the CBD, hence the congestion.
Yes.
Now, these individuals were given priority. They were given chance to apply and be part of the bus company. That was in 2012, when the plan was still on paper. Now, with what happened after? We see what is happening now. Now buses are competing with taxis for passengers. Buses are making random stops instead of stopping at bus stops. Buses are doing what taxis are doing. Actually, now the congestion has become
survival for the fittest.
Exactly, congestion has become
the norm of the
twofold.
Yes. Well, thank you very much, Andrew, for that insight. We'll have Andrew again on further segments to discuss more on the transport challenges in our metropolitan area.